Welcome, everyone. This is Robin Duncan, and I'm here with my husband, Terry Macy.
Hello, everyone. Good to be with you.
We are your hosts for the A Course in Miracles Global Study Group, and tonight we will be covering the fifth class on Chapter 13. It is a doozy, and we will be specifically covering Section Number 7 on Attainment of the Real World. Well, that sounds great. Of course, we want to attain the real world. Okay, let's go ahead and get started with an opening prayer. Dear God, we come to you tonight together. We place our future in your hands. Sometimes we worry. We think about what might happen or can happen or what we might fear, and then we get anxious. Today, we join together in welcoming the highest and happiest outcome for each one here and all of our loved ones. There are those of us that have loved ones that are in turmoil, or they are sick, or they are in the hospital, and they are going through things that they do not understand, that none of us understand. We ask, Holy Spirit, that you would decide for us, for each one of us and our loved ones, that you would choose peace on our behalf. If there is any place in our mind where we have decided against a peaceful and happy outcome, we wholly give this to you right now. We want the peace of God for everyone, and we ask that you would show us our way back to the light of truth, such that we can recognize it and experience it. Your will be done. Amen. Well, tonight, as we look at the attainment of the real world, I have been hearing from a few different people that there are concerns about the future and how everything seems unstable, and you're not seeing all the signs you would like to see that things are turning around. Remember that the ego's device is to hide from your eyes that you are making any progress at all. But one way we can move around this is to remember that it's not about our progress. It is about our perfect guide. Within each one of us, there is a perfect guide, being the Holy Spirit. I call the Holy Spirit our teacher of peace. And you see, even if we do not see it with our eyes, it does not mean that things are not happening on our behalf. Today, let's be willing to trust God. Sometimes that's hard because in the past we might have prayed about things or asked for things, and maybe we did not see those things occur. But we are learning from the Course that the Holy Spirit is the one to orchestrate the plan. The Holy Spirit is the one that understands what we need and what will best serve us in this awakening process. And sometimes we ask for things that are really not in our own best interest. And I know I've done this in the past where I have asked for certain solutions that did not happen. And then 1 month or 2 months down the road, I could look back and see the absolute brilliance of not receiving what I asked for, because other details began to unfold that showed me that there was a greater plan than I was aware of. Let's be willing to lay down all of our ideas about what we think we need. Let's understand that God is pure and total love, and that we are deeply and dearly loved. In Lesson 194, which is so wonderful, it's called, I Place the Future in the Hands of God. It says, what worry can beset the one who gives his future to the loving hands of God? What can he suffer? What can cause him pain or bring experience of loss to him? What can he fear? And what can he regard except with love? And then further down in paragraph number 9, it says, for in God's hands we rest untroubled, sure that only good can come to us. If we forget, we will be gently reassured. If we accept an unforgiving thought, it will be soon replaced by love's reflection. And if we are tempted to attack, We will appeal to Him who guards our rest to make the choice for us that leaves temptation far behind. No longer is the world our enemy, for we have chosen that we be its friend. And what I love about this paragraph is that we are reminded that we are not alone. This is a collaboration of love. We are the one to invite the healing, and Holy Spirit is the one to bring the answers, the solutions, the guidance, the direction. If we forget, we will be reassured by Holy Spirit. If we have an unforgiving thought, which we will, we probably do 100 times a day. Maybe I'm just talking about myself, but I still do. But it says it will soon be replaced by love's reflection. And if we're tempted to attack with our thoughts, with our judgments, then we will be given what allows that temptation to be left far behind. You notice it doesn't say that God decides for us and does all our thinking for us so that these things never happen again. It says that every time we think we get off track, there's an answer to put us back on track. Think about the peace of this. We are not required to be without fear. We are not required to have perfect thoughts. We are asked to not decide against ourselves. And we do this when we start to have worry thoughts, fear thoughts. And all of us have them. The point is to not jump on the train and ride the train. Step off the train of fear, because the sooner you do and you make room for Holy Spirit to decide for you, He says He will gently reassure you. He will replace those thoughts with His own, and He will help you to leave temptation far behind. He is the answer, and we are the questioner. So don't put that burden on yourself of thinking that you have to have all the perfect thoughts and all the perfect prayers, and you have to have all your ducks lined up in a perfect row in order to get your answer. You are entitled to happiness. It is God's will that you are happy and that you know the greatness of His love. Today we join together in laying down the script that we are tempted to write that would include an unhappy outcome. I call this put the pen down. It means when you are tempted in your mind to write an unhappy outcome for yourself, simply put the pen down in your mind and turn that space, think of it as a canvas in your mind, turn that over to Holy Spirit and say, will you fill this in for me? It is not up to you to be perfect because your guide is perfect. Today, as we talk about attainment of the real world, I know when I first started studying the Course that the real world was a really difficult concept. In fact, I kept asking, Holy Spirit, what do you mean, the real world? I mean, this is the only world I know. Look around. This is it. And through very many glimpses, I've been shown that this is not all there is. Let's just put it that way. That as our mind begins to open and our thoughts begin to clear, we begin to see much more love in the world. We see much more peace and happiness and opportunity. And we begin to have even an excited attitude towards the future and eagerness, because we know that Holy Spirit is the deliverer. And we begin to have this beautiful faith in that divine process that loves us so deeply. Today, as we are willing to consider that the world we see with our eyes is not actually the real world. It's simply that we fell asleep to our own true reality at some point. Even when we sleep at night, we wake up the next morning and we realize that we were dreaming. But A Course in Miracles is teaching us that we have not yet fully awakened. And we will, at the guidance of Holy Spirit. And there are some things we can do to speed that along, but you see, this is the goal, to fully awaken from the dream. And He teaches us that as we awaken and as we are willing to invite Holy Spirit to guide us, to decide for us, about everything so that we can be gently reassured that our outcome will be happy as we do this, then our nightmares begin to turn into happy dreams. He's referring to our daytime dreams, the life that we live right now. He says, you will first dream of peace and then awaken to it. You see, we are being prepared for that awakening because it is so happy, so beautiful, lovely, colorful, wonderful, that we have to be prepared for that awakening. So our dreams of despair and sadness and feeling lost and alone and broke and homeless, these dreams will shift to happy dreams. And then we will awaken because we will be ready. We will be prepared for that great happiness because we will already be happy. I want you to hold in your heart tonight that this is Holy Spirit's promise, that the plan is already unfolding and you are included in that plan. In fact, the plan is intended for you by God Himself. And this rescue cannot fail because Holy Spirit is perfect. He says the Holy Spirit cannot fail. It is not up to us. Take in a nice deep sigh of relief. And remember, it is not up to you. You need do nothing. It is helpful to not decide against your own happy, happy outcome. And whenever you're in fear, pause and remind yourself it's okay to be afraid. You just do not want to dwell in the fear. Pause and say, Holy Spirit, decide for me. I'm feeling this fear about blank, blank, blank. Please decide for me about this so that I can be assured of a happy outcome. Today we are willing to open our mind to the attainment of the real world. And in this section, he's giving us some great tips about how to awaken more quickly. And we are listening because I know each one of us here would sure love to see that happiness that is consistent and only grows greater and happier over time. We would love to see that right now together. All right, Terry, can you launch us forward with a little laughter?
Absolutely. So my laughter for today is called The Startled Taxi Driver. Well, a passenger, while riding in the back of a taxi, tapped the taxi driver on the shoulder from behind to ask him a question. Screamed the driver. He lost control of the car, nearly hit a bus, went up on the sidewalk, and stopped inches from crashing through a store window. For a second, everything was quiet in the cab, except for the heavy breathing of the driver. Then the driver said, while breathing fast and holding his hand over his heart, "Look, mate, don't ever do that again. You scared the living daylights out of me." Well, the passenger apologized and said, "I didn't realize that a little tap on your back from behind would scare you so much." The driver replied, "Sorry, it's not really your fault. Today is my first day as a cab driver. For the last 25 years, I've been driving a funeral van."
See, we all get stuck in our habits. Case in point.
Who is tapping me on the shoulder?
That would be scary. You do not want that to happen in a funeral van. That's pretty funny. Okay. See, we all have habits to break, right? So even simple things can be very difficult. So we have to love ourselves and forgive ourselves. All right, Terry, let's go ahead and start out here with Chapter 13, Section 7, Attainment of the Real World. You can almost hear like French horns playing in the background. So, Attainment of the Real World, paragraph number 1.
Sit quietly and look upon the world you see and tell yourself, the real world is not like this. It has no buildings and there are no streets where people walk alone and separate. There are no stores where people buy an endless list of things they do not need. It is not lit with artificial light, and night comes not upon it. There is no day that brightens and grows dim. There is no loss. Nothing is there but shines and shines forever.
And to that I say it is a great relief, right?
Yeah.
To know that the world we see is not the real world. Now, the world we see has some beautiful points to it, beautiful moments, but the real world is perfectly consistent as we are taught. Some people might say, well, that sounds kind of boring. A world, there's no nighttime, there's no contrasts and things like that, and I don't know, that doesn't sound very exciting. But what I've found in my little moments of seeing behind the curtain, so to speak, is that during those moments, there was no sense of sorrow of any kind. There was no fear. There was no sense of loss. You felt absolutely expanded, infinite, powerful. There was nothing missing, total fulfillment. And the times I've experienced this were only glimpses, moments at a time. And I know that what we are headed towards is something much greater than this. So realize while we may not have nighttime and daytime, you would have so much love known in your heart that your heart would just pour over in happiness. Imagine everything around you being known to you as part of you, where there is nothing missing, there's no gap, there's no idea of separation. So it's hard for any of us to conceive what this might be, but we learn in the Course that it's 1,000 times greater than our most joyful thought. Think about your most joyful times in life, the times when you laughed until your sides hurt. If you've had that experience, it's pretty funny. Some people haven't had that, and I look forward to you having that. Or maybe your first glimpse at a new child or a new niece or nephew, or when you just have these moments of absolute joy, and then multiply that joy times 1,000, and then string it together into one continuous eternal moment, and that's why it cannot be contained in this body. Know that our awakening is something that is so great and good. You will be so happy that you did. It's hard for us to see that side of the bridge from our side, but Holy Spirit is assuring us that we will be so happy when we reawaken and remember. Paragraph number 2.
The world you see must be denied, for sight of it is costing you a different kind of vision.
Now it's telling us that the world we see must be denied, because you can only focus on one world at a time. The real world is not about illusions, and the illusory world is not about the real world, but yet we are in this experience of illusion, so you might wonder, what is denial? How do you deny this world when you are in it? I think one of the ways that Terry and I practice that is when we see things that are beautiful, we just let them be and appreciate beauty and greatness and all the good things of life, understanding that it is an effect of our mind. It is not the cause of our happiness. It is an effect of our happiness, and to be really grateful about that. And when we see things that disturb our peace, we also understand that those are things that are representing our past thoughts and beliefs. So our challenge is to look at those experiences that bring up fear, that make us feel alone or powerless or separated or sick, and to question what we see. A Course in Miracles says we are very quick to question God, but we are not quick to question what we see, questioning our illusions. And so that's what we practice each day together, and it's really great to have a partner to practice with. Even if you know someone that practices in the same way that you do, give them permission to help you remember. Like if you're going down the road of worry or gossip without thinking about it, have the other person gently and lovingly say, maybe we can pray about this, or maybe we can put it back in the light and ask for guidance about this. Be gentle, be loving. This is not about judgment, but it's really great to help each other to stay on track, because every time we invest our thoughts into something that is less than loving, then we experience the effects of our thoughts. Now, Holy Spirit will help us with those effects, but wouldn't it be great to not have to go down that road just so that we can do a U-turn and come back? We would make much more progress if we stay on the road of love without judgment, and then Holy Spirit can truly show us our way back to that awakening much more quickly. Let's go now to sentence two.
You cannot see both worlds, for each of them involves a different kind of seeing and depends on what you cherish. The sight of one is possible because you have denied the other. Both are not true, yet either one will seem as real to you as the amount to which you hold it dear. And yet their power is not the same, because their real attraction to you is unequal.
And I go back to trying to walk through this world when we know this is not the real world, and yet we function here, at least until we don't. So don't try to overthink this in terms of denying the world you see. It's just about the understanding that you are looking at your own projection, your story that you made up in the place of the truth. Holy Spirit is going to help you correct this whole thing. It is up to the Holy Spirit that you are successful in this. So don't put that pressure on your own shoulders to get this worked out for yourself. You are not your own healer. Once you understand that you're looking at projection instead of the truth, what if God said, okay, I'm going to take you, my beloved one, that I love so dearly and deeply, and I am with you forever, eternally, and you have my love, my provision, you cannot be lacking anything, and you are asking to go over here to this playground, let's say. You're on the playground, and God is reminding you, okay, honey, have fun. But realize on this playground that you're on, everything you think about, good and bad, you're going to see as if it's real. It's not real, my love. I am real. Our love for each other is real. I am always here. I will always take care of you. Your love, your home, everything that you are is with me, and I will ensure your happiness forever and ever. But when you go over to that playground, which you are asking me to do, when you get there, I want you to realize that everything you think about, you're going to see it as if it's real. If you have a scary thought, like you could be homeless, you might see yourself coming up to that situation. If you have a scary thought that you could be sick, even though I never created sickness for you, you might actually see yourself having these symptoms of sickness. If you hold on to the thoughts that we could be separate for some reason, well, that's ridiculous, but if you hold that thought in your mind, you might just see the experience or have an experience where you think, I have left you. I cannot leave you. You are my beloved. I will never, ever leave you. So I want you to know on this playground, it's a little challenging because you are going to see what you think about. And when you do this, you will not be able to see the real world that I created for you. While you do this, it is going to feel confusing. But my love, never forget, I am with you. You can call to me in an instant. I have provided you the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has every answer. The Holy Spirit knows of my love and also knows what you are facing, even in the smallest little detail, right down to the shoelaces in your shoes. Whatever you need, the Holy Spirit is there. But do not invest your thoughts in what is not real, or you will not hear the guidance of Holy Spirit as I have offered you. Stay focused on me, on my voice. Listen to only my voice, even in the midst of all that is going on that playground, but realize it is not true. It is not so. It has no power, because the power is within you where I have placed it. Remember my love. Don't ever forget, or you will be afraid and you have nothing to fear. Turn to me. Ask me what to do. I will guide you, but you cannot listen to two guides. And on the playground, you have the teacher of pain that you made up, and don't listen to it, because while you're listening to that, you will not hear me, even though I am speaking. And so, my love, I will gently reassure you, you are safe, provided for. I created you whole, and you cannot be altered by anything of the world on that playground. Remember the truth, and it will set you free. Paragraph number 3.
You do not really want the world you see, for it has disappointed you since time began. The homes you built have never sheltered you. The roads you made have led you nowhere, and no city that you built has withstood the crumbling assault of time. Nothing you made but has the mark of death upon it. Hold it not dear, for it is old and tired and ready to return to dust, even as you made it. This aching world has not the power to touch the living world at all. You could not give it that, and so, although you turn in sadness from it, you cannot find in it the road that leads away from it into another world.
I feel like the message that is asking to be shared right now is that in order to know the real world, you do not have to be perfect about this. You can simply borrow on the idea that the world you see with your eyes is not it. It's not the real world. And that's enough to place a question mark in your mind that the Holy Spirit can fulfill. So realize that the world you see is not the real world. And you may not know what the real world is yet, but that's okay. Simply understanding that you're on your way to your awareness of it is enough to bring correction to the world you see. Once we understand that what we are looking at is not the truth and that it has no power to deprive us, take from us, or ever make us sick or homeless, when we just understand that that's the truth, even though we don't have it all sorted out, well, that makes room in our mind for the Holy Spirit to enter and show us what is true. God cannot give us what we are unwilling to have. If we believe that our projected world is the real world and we have no interest in what is real, well, that will appear to stay that way until we change our mind. So it is not up to you. You do not have to be perfect, but you must recognize that the world you see is not the real one and that you would want the real one instead of this. And that's what starts the tumblers going. That's what invites the Holy Spirit to accomplish the healing on your behalf. Paragraph number 4.
Yet the real world has the power to touch you even here because you love it. And what you call with love will come to you.
It's interesting because I just feel like Holy Spirit's whispering in my ear tonight, because every time he says something, it's like it's followed up by the next paragraph, which I really don't know what's in the next paragraph. But what he's saying there is, yet the real world has the power to touch you even here because you love it. You want the real world. You're from the real world. You are the real world. That's why this world feels so strange, why you feel unfamiliar here, disconnected. There's a reason for that, right? And what he's saying is that the real world can touch you even here. We don't have to wait until the end of time and all the sidewalks roll up and disappear before we have a happy experience. The real world touches us here because we love it and because we are here. And in that holy instant, we can have a happy outcome right here. Remember, he says, your nightmares will turn to happy dreams, and then you will be ready to wake up. We have to actually practice being happy for a while, which means that we are happy, and we have to actually be in that state of mind for a while before we would even be remotely ready for our complete awakening. I want you to look forward to this. The happiness that is right here, right now, being handed to you, but do not decide on something less. And even if you're scared, and even if you don't know the future, which you have never known the future, I used to tell myself that, well, I don't know what's going to happen. And I could hear Holy Spirit say, you've never known what was going to happen. It's almost like you like to tell yourself you used to know, but you've never known. I do not know what will happen. I cannot know what will happen. I have no idea what's going to happen in the next 5 minutes. And for those of you that are in fear or worry right now or feeling sick, what we do know is that God is love, and love loves you, and love is trying to show you a happier way of life. that is free of pain and suffering and lack and being deprived, free of loneliness and despair and suffering. But we must refuse what we see with our eyes simply by saying, Holy Spirit, decide for me about this. I will not decide against myself today. Sentence 3.
Oh, I also wanted to share from the previous paragraph in one of the sentences here. In the previous paragraph where it says you do not really want the world you see, it has disappointed you since time began, the homes you built never sheltered you, the roads you made have led nowhere. I was reading that the other day, and I ended up drawing a little picture for myself. It really kind of laid it out well, and I don't know if people would want to try this, but it really brought it home to me even more, is I pictured on the sheet of paper a vast ocean, and then I drew a little boat out in the middle of the ocean floating on the water and just drew a stick guy, which is me, out there in the boat floating on the ocean. And I kind of thought of the ocean as life. And the boat, which was floating above water, luckily at the time, happened to be my current stable situation. Then what I drew are other boats all around me in the ocean, some partially sinking, some already sunk all the way on the bottom, others just a little bit sunk, and a few others were on the water. And I wrote on the side of each of those boats past things that I tried that I thought would make life work, be better, make life happier. Certain companies I worked for, situations I was in, jobs I went after, certain levels of income I was after. Previously, before studying the course, they had all failed. And so it was this sea of sunken boats of all these different things. And I even drew other boats on the surface that hadn't sunk yet that one might think, you know, if I could just swim to that boat over there and get on that one because it's got X written on the side of it that it represents, that's $10,000 more a month in income or something. That'll make life work. Gee, if I could just swim over to that boat. But to realize, you know, even if you could, eventually that boat will sink too and you'll start looking for another boat because it was all about looking for some boat in the world with something on board that would make life work. And until I realized no boat on this ocean is going to do anything, the ocean's an illusion, the boat's an illusion, everything on every boat is an illusion. And yet it's also from the next paragraph where it says, yet the real world has the power to touch you even here. It's okay to be in a boat that doesn't sink, but for the right reasons. Just wanted to share that.
That is beautiful, and I'm sure everybody loved that too, because we love our images to be able to noodle these things out in our mind, right? So thank you, Terry. That was awesome. I was thinking about being out on that ocean. One of the things in previous classes that we would talk about is bringing your oars in the boat. Our temptation is to try to paddle around, like Terry said, try to get to that other boat because yours is sinking, or maybe you're in the water and you're doggy paddling, but let's just say that you're in this boat, it seems to be sinking, and you don't know what to do, and the last thing you would want to do, you think, is to pull your oars in and not try to paddle somewhere. But it is a true surrender. It's an understanding that the plan is not up to us. Bring your oars in the boat. Give it to Holy Spirit fully, and that's really giving it. If your boat was starting to sink and you don't know where you're going, but you just feel like you should be paddling somewhere, because we've learned the lessons of if you're not helping you, that God will not help you, or God helps those who only help themselves and all that. And I have to say I stand up to that, because God is love, and any parent, even a human parent, would not let their child sink because they didn't know the answer. God will not let you sink, but you must be willing to recognize that love, be willing to ask to know that love, and to have that love ignited in your heart again, so that you would be willing to know what that feels like, to be loved so deeply that even in a sinking boat with no oars, that you would be delivered from that situation, that you would be shown your way to a safe oasis. Or then, everybody, it's not easy. Think about how hard that would be in that moment of distress, but we don't know where we're going anyway. We can't see the land, and pull those oars in and relax and give it to God. I need do nothing. It is not up to me. Sentence 3.
Love always answers, being unable to deny a call for help or not to hear the cries of pain that rise to it from every part of the strange world you made but do not want, all that you need to give this world away in glad exchange for what you did not make is willingness to learn the one you made is false.
It's funny, I can almost hear an alarm going off in my head, like ding, 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 ding.
Yeah.
And what it's saying is that notice how little it is. All we need in order to give the world away that we see, the one that's filled with pain and hurt and sorrow, is to be willing to learn that the one we made is false. That's it. It's a very short list, actually. But our problem is that we believe what we see is the truth. It's our reality. It's our destiny. It's our outcome. Then we decide it's going to get worse or we'll have nothing at all. And we must stop this. That's the way that we can really quicken our steps for ourselves. Holy Spirit is the one to bring us the answer, but we can do a lot to not drag our feet. Imagine trying to walk somebody to something that they're dragging their feet, literally. And we do this every time we decide what we see is real, and on top of that, we believe it's going to get worse. So stop, pause, forgive yourself, choose again. And it doesn't mean you have to now lay pink paint over it or decide the perfect answer. It just means, Holy Spirit, I have this fear that things aren't going so well or that they might get worse. Will you decide for me about that? Because I am willing to learn that the world I made is false, false, and I want the truth instead of this. This is the entry point. It's wonderful once we begin to realize we are not alone. Paragraph 5.
You have been wrong about the world because you have misjudged yourself. From such a twisted reference point, what could you see? All seeing starts with the perceiver who judges what is true and what is false. And what he judges false, he does not see.
So it's telling us there that we are wrong about the world because of our judgments. This is why the teacher of God must learn to be free of judgment. We're all trying every day. Terry and I have not perfected it, but we intend to. Don't we, Terry?
Absolutely.
I don't want to speak for you. We do want to be free of all judgment, and we are not there yet because our judgments show us a world that is so painful sometimes and where people are hurt and those boats are sinking. It's saying that all seeing starts with the perceiver, the one that is judging what is true and false. And the moment we hold a judgment that is not true, we no longer see what is true and we block our own vision. Thank goodness we're not alone. Thank goodness for page 90, where it says, Holy Spirit will undo all the consequences of our wrong decisions. Thank goodness we have a perfect guide that knows where we get off track. It's okay. Forgive yourself. I forgive myself. And Terry forgives himself. We forgive ourselves. But don't drag your feet by doing it again and again and again. Catch yourself. When you're in judgment, when you're seeing another person as corrupted, dishonest, a liar, unworthy, incapable, incompetent, even sick. When we see someone as less than what God created them to be, then we are now going to see a world that is filled with that same judgment. We are going to see what we choose to be true in the place of truth. And we do have the choice to do this differently. This is what really picks things up to a more rapid pace. Sentence 5.
You who would judge reality cannot see it, for whenever judgment enters, reality has slipped away.
Think of this, that whenever you are in judgment about yourself, about someone else, you are seeing you or them as less than whole, reality slips away. You cannot have both. You must tell yourself this again and again. You cannot have truth and illusions. You cannot know love and fear. You cannot know joy and anger. The minute you choose one, you forfeit your awareness of the other. This must be understood because I think at a deeper level, we think we can go ahead and crank out those judgments about those people over there and still call on God to know the greatness of his love over here. God is always loving us, and that greatness is always there. But you see, reality slips away from our mind when we go into judgment. Let's be willing to be free of it. Let's catch it quick and often. Sentence 6.
The out of mind is out of sight, because what is denied is there but is not recognized. Christ is still there, although you know him not. His being does not depend upon your recognition. He lives within you in the quiet present and waits for you to leave the past behind and enter into the world he holds out to you in love.
Let's say that you're in a room filled with light and you're really enjoying yourself and having a good time, and then all of a sudden the lights go out. You know that light is available, maybe even outside your home, or I don't know, just say for a moment, the lights go out and you become disoriented. You would be very likely to try to figure your way out around the room and try to navigate in the darkness without trying to figure out the light, like stay focused on the light. Just notice that whenever darkness appears, which is the absence of light, in truth it's nothing at all. Whenever darkness appears in our mind, our temptation to focus on it, navigate through it, overcome it, overpower it, becomes very high. But think of this, if we focus only on the voice of our teacher of peace, only on the guidance that we are given, knowing that that's where the light comes from, then we don't have to figure out how to navigate. We need to stay focused on what is true, and then the guidance will be given us. And the light will be shown to us again. So realize your own temptation that in the midst of fear and darkness and worry, we tend to just go full on into trying to navigate it, get through it, survive it, overcome it. We are not asked to do this. We are asked to pause. Remember, we need do nothing, because wherever there is darkness, it is the absence of light. So we need to focus on the light. We will never get back to the light in our mind by rummaging through the darkness. It doesn't work that way. The light is. It has never been missing. When it is missing in your mind, whether through resources or love or connection or health, question it. God did not intend for you to have that condition, and ask Holy Spirit to guide you 100%. Stay focused on the light, even if it's only in your mind, even if you're just imagining what that might look like, and stay focused on only one voice, and you will notice that the darkness gets corrected for you. Paragraph number 6.
No one in this distracted world but has seen some glimpses of the other world about him. Yet while he still lays value on his own, he will deny the vision of the other, maintaining that he loves what he loves not, and following not the road that love points out. Love leads so gladly.
Now, I don't know if you all have had glimpses of the other world. I think sometimes when we just feel overcome with love and joy, those are glimpses. When we see something of such great beauty that it takes our breath away, I think those are glimpses. I've had several. This is one I probably haven't shared very much, but we were doing a healing class. It was called a healing buffet. Terry and I had a property at that point. It was about 1.5 acres. Beautiful foliage all around. There were people sitting in pairs and helping each other through the healing process, praying together. It was just lovely. And for a moment, while everyone was working together, we heard a choir singing. Now, mind you, we're out in an area that's pretty rural and lots of trees. There is nothing close where there would be a choir. And they were loud, as if they were maybe 100 feet away, like a full-on choir. All of a sudden, it's like if you open the door to a gymnasium where there was a choir, and maybe it was soundproof. So when you open the door, you hear them, and they sang about 2 lines. In the middle of the sentence, it was like someone closed the door. And they stopped. And we all looked at each other like, what was that? We're like, oh my goodness. Everyone heard it. It was amazing. And we looked all around. There was just no way anything was close enough to us where there could have been a choir that could be that large, that sounded that great, that could just start and stop in the middle of a sentence. I think that happened to show us that it was a little heavenly glimpse, and it was amazing. And I've had many little glimpses, and I wish those for you. If you have not had them, you will. Stay focused on what is true. It will just blow your mind. So there is so much more than we can see with our eyes. Sometimes looking at what you see and thinking, this is not real, this is not real, that's kind of tough. But what you can tell yourself is, what if there's more than what I see? I could be willing to acknowledge that. What if I'm not seeing everything? What if there's more to see than this? It's kind of a way to tiptoe around your ego, and it works really well. All right, sentence number 4.
Well, I wanted to share one of my glimpses.
Awesome.
It was the moment we married and said I do to each other, the island of Kauai in Hawaii. As we said that, we were in this dense, lush, tropical setting at what I think is the first church ever on the island of Kauai.
The oldest
and
church,
Yeah, the Hawaiian musicians were playing there as part of ceremony. And right after you and I said, I do, all of these tropical birds started singing out loud. And even to the point where the local Hawaiians kind of stopped playing and were like looking up at the trees like, what is going on? These beautiful birds were singing so loudly that it was so obvious they were joining in our enjoyment.
It was so obvious. And it was right as we finished our vows. And our vows included words of service and really using our relationship for helping in the world and extending in the world and for God to use us as instruments. That makes me tear up just thinking about it, because right at the end of our vows, they started chirping so loud. It was obvious they were responding to our wedding. Hawaiians had said that was a huge blessing on our marriage, according to them, because they said the birds, I believe, were called a shaman thrush, and that they don't really come out that much and they don't really sing that much. So they were just telling us afterward what a wonderful blessing that was, and it sure felt like it.
Yeah, even if they started 5 seconds sooner, they would have drowned out what we were saying. They
That's
started
how loud
perfectly
it was, right?
On cue, perfectly on cue right after we stopped.
It was beautiful. We just did another wedding for a renewal of vows, and I officiated a ceremony for my nephew and his wife, and they were married 20 years, so we renewed their vows at Disneyland. It was really awesome there, too, because we went over on the side of Sleeping Beauty's castle, and we had gotten permission to do the vows. But right as they finished their vows, I think the Disneyland folks just decided to give us some fun, and they played beautiful, like, fairy tale music in the background with a beautiful woman singing. And as soon as we finished the ceremony, all this beautiful music started playing and birds started chirping. We had no idea that they even had put that together. Just kind of reminded me of our moment, Terry. So sweet.
Right.
So that's because I married right, right?
Me too.
Let's go to sentence number 4.
As you follow him, you will rejoice that you have found his company and learned of him the joyful journey home.
I wanted to emphasize that word, follow him. It is not up to you. I have to say that again and again to myself as well. It is not up to us to figure all this out, to have all the right answers, to know all the right prayers. As we follow him, we will rejoice because we will have found his company and learned of him the joyful journey home. So your part and ours is to follow him. Follow the Christ, follow the Holy Spirit's guidance, and you have nothing to fear. If you don't know that you're doing it, your guide will gently reassure you and get you back on track. It is your guide's responsibility to make sure you are successful. If you mess it up, you will be corrected as long as you are asking to be corrected. Sentence 5.
You wait, but for yourself, to give this sad world over and exchange your errors for the peace of God is but your will. And Christ will always offer you the will of God and recognition that you share it with him.
He's basically telling us that waking up and knowing our true identity and our heavenly home and state of awareness, our oneness with God, that is our will. That's already done. That's already happened, and it's happening now. But while we are focusing on a world that we made up, that is not real, that is blocking our awareness of what is true, we are not even aware of our own will. So this is what this whole course is about, is reminding us of what is true, what is ours, and how to get back to what we already desire in truth. Paragraph 7.
It is God's will that nothing touch his Son except himself, and nothing else comes nigh unto him. He is as safe from pain as God himself, who watches over him in everything. The world about him shines with love because God placed him in himself where pain is not, and love surrounds him without end or flaw.
I would love for you to underline sentence number 2. He is as safe from pain as God himself, who watches over him in everything. We can turn that into an I statement. I am as safe from pain and lack and illness and suffering and loneliness be as God himself, who watches over me in everything. If you need to write that on a piece of paper and put it right in front of you, it's such a beautiful sentence and reminder. Now, sometimes we don't feel safe because we have decided we are not. That's all that has gone wrong here. We are still safe. We will always be safe. But when we think we are not safe and that we could fail and that we could fall, we might experience ourselves as failing or falling. That is because the power of decision is our own, meaning what we decide, even if it's illusions in the place of truth, we will experience them because we are choosing them. We are cherishing them more than we are cherishing the truth. We are as safe from pain and lack as God himself, who watches over us in everything. Sentence 4.
Disturbance of his peace can never be. In perfect sanity, he looks on love, for it is all about him and within him. He must deny the world of pain the instant he perceives the arms of love around him. And from this point of safety, he looks quietly about him and recognizes that the world is one with him.
In this couple of sentences, I just wanted to recognize the sequence of things. He's saying he must deny the world of pain the instant he perceives the arms of love around him. Well, certainly, if you felt the arms of love around you, you might find your ability to deny the pain. But let's recognize that in order to feel the arms of love around us, we must first welcome them and first invite them and first imagine that they are there and that we are entitled to them, that we are worthy of them. Then we feel those arms of love around us because we have chosen to welcome them. And then, with those arms of love around us, we deny the world of pain because we can feel the arms of love around us. So I want you to realize that you may not fully deny the world of pain until you feel those arms of love around you. But the way that you're going to get to that feeling is you must welcome it, choose it, invite it, and be committed to it. Because if you invite those arms of love today, but you reject them tomorrow morning by thinking that you're alone, nobody's there, you can't count on anybody, well, you will have the experience of those arms of love not being there. Because we already learned in the previous paragraph that when you focus on illusions, reality slips away from your mind, but only from your mind. But that's where everything gets decided, so that's a pretty important place. So remember, we must invite those arms of love, then we feel them around us, then we are able to fully deny the world of pain. And from this point of safety, we can look quietly around us, recognize that the world is one with us. Of course, but that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to get there. And it starts with that invitation and a commitment and a vigilance for love. Paragraph 8.
The peace of God passeth your understanding only in the past. Yet here it is, and you can understand it now. God loves his son forever, and his son returns his father's love forever. The real world is the way that leads you to remembrance of the one thing that is wholly true and wholly yours. For all else you have lent yourself in time, and it will fade. But this one thing is always yours, being the gift of God unto his Son. Your one reality was given you, and by it God created you as one with him.
I wrote in the margin beside this paragraph, just God's gift to me. We are given the gift of God's love forever, and this is ours forever. This gift cannot be undone. It cannot be changed. Even when we decide that we are without it or that we are in a world where it does not exist, even when we make those decisions and then we see them as if they are real because we decided that they could be real, we are willing to see that differently and remember God's gift, the gift of love forever. And love is loving. And if that which loves you is the all-powerful, infinite God, creator of all in all, omnipotent, supreme, all wisdom, all substance and intelligence, if that is what loves you, you truly have nothing to fear. Remind yourself frequently, ask Holy Spirit to decide for you, and pretty soon you will feel those arms of love around you in a way that is meaningful and tangible. Paragraph 9.
You will first dream of peace, and then awaken to it.
Let's underline and star that sentence. You might want to make a little plaque out of that. I put it on my quotes list for potential plaques in my home. You will first dream of peace, and then awaken to it. So we're on our way to this awakening, but you see, we have to get really good at peace, which means happiness and joy and a life that we love and feeling the connection and the grace of God in our lives. We have to actually first dream of that at the guidance of Holy Spirit before we can awaken to it. Remember, the memory of awakening is so great, we actually have to allow our minds to be prepared for that memory. Sentence 2.
Your first exchange of what you made for what you want is the exchange of nightmares for the happy dreams of love.
There it is, in print. We're going to exchange all of our unhappy experiences for happy experiences. All of them. Think about that. All of them. We are not doing it. Holy Spirit is doing it. And I know that Terry and I both can attest to our lives being completely overhauled, that we have been restored on just about every single level. I'm sure there's still more miracles coming our way. But the peace we feel today, the love, the joy, the connection with family and friends, all of you are in that extended family list, so you are our family and our friends. To know that love and to feel it and to not be afraid anymore, to not worry like we might have worried before. We first exchange those nightmares for the happy dreams of love. It does happen. Bank on it. Count on it. Get on the team that welcomes it and be unwilling to entertain those thoughts of fear for very long because they give us nothing that we want. Sentence 3.
In these lie your true perceptions, for the Holy Spirit corrects the world of dreams where all perception is. Knowledge needs no correction, yet the dreams of love lead unto knowledge. In them you see nothing fearful, and because of this, they are the welcome that you offer knowledge.
When he's talking about true perception, perception is only needed here in the world of illusions because we went from an absolute realm of knowledge where perception is not needed. If you know something exists, no one could talk you out of it, no matter what their perception is. That knowledge overrides the need for perception. But as we accepted that we could be separate from God, and then we have a misperception about that, we are now looking at a world that seems to represent that misperception. And so he's telling us that as we get to a place of true perception, which is in the direction of the truth, let's say someone does something that you find was awful, and you're willing to pause and say, I am willing to not judge this person, because this is not the truth. I want to see the truth in them, the light in them, the face of Christ in them that God created, because I'm looking at the story I made up. I'm not looking at the truth of them, and I want the truth instead of this. If we can get to that place of consciousness, that is reflecting true perception. It's still perception. We're still looking at it in a certain way. We're still not completely aware of true knowledge, but it is a perception that is headed in the direction of the truth. So we could call it true perception. Just wanted to make that distinction, that true perception, which is the refusal of illusions, refusal of the story we made up, those true perceptions lead us to the happy dreams of love, which lead us to our full awakening. Sentence 7.
Love waits on welcome, not on time, and the real world is but your welcome of what always was. Therefore, the call of joy is in it, and your glad response is your awakening to what you have not lost.
There's one of my favorite quotes, love waits on welcome, not on time. Even if you put a period, that's so beautiful. The whole sentence is even greater. But let's remember that love waits on welcome. It's not waiting on us to have the right prayers, have the right thoughts, to do all the right things. It waits on welcome. But every time we judge someone as less than whole, we are not welcoming love. We are going to have the memory of love slide away from our mind because we are choosing illusions instead of love. Let's choose love. Paragraph 10.
Praise then the Father for the perfect sanity of his most holy Son. Your Father knoweth that you have need of nothing. In heaven this is so, for what could you need in eternity?
As you claim for yourself right now, I need nothing because God created me whole, complete, and provided for. There is nothing I need. You see, there's a part of your mind that says, you're crazy. Of course you need things. You need this and this and this and this, right? But if we listen to that voice, do you see the teacher we are listening to, the teacher of pain? And remember that the teacher of pain has no interest in you ever getting what you want or feeling safe or loved or happy or whole. So when we listen to the voice that says we do not have and we need to get, we're listening to the voice of the ego. When you remind yourself, I am God's holy, precious child, I have everything, there is nothing missing, God created me to know the greatness of his love, to feel it, to experience it, and to enjoy it forever and ever. This is an absolute slap in the face to the voice of the ego that tells you you're missing this and this and this and this. Realize the team you are committed to. Get on the side of the team you would like to be on. Sometimes it feels like you're in denial when you're saying, I have everything. But really what you are doing is declaring your allegiance to what is true, and you are questioning what is false. It's not about denial. It's about opening your mind to what is true. The next thing you know, you're going to hear a choir singing to you from heaven, and then the door closes, and you're thinking, what was that? So let's get over here on this side. Let's listen to the teacher that will provide for us and make sure that we have a home and our health and our well-being. That teacher will not let us down. But we have to start claiming what is true, because the decision has to be made in order for us to see it as true. Remember, the welcome has to be made before the arms of love are known to us again, and then we can truly deny the world of pain. Otherwise, it's just words, right? We want to be able to deny it from a level of certainty, and that comes from our guide and teacher. Sentence 4.
In your world, you do need things. It is a world of scarcity in which you find yourself because you are lacking. Yet, can you find yourself in such a world? Without the Holy Spirit, the answer would be no. Yet because of him, the answer is a joyous yes.
I think it's asking there, can you find yourself, your true self in this world that is based on scarcity and lack, where you do need things, and he's saying that you cannot find yourself without me. I'm your guide back to what is true and real, thank goodness. So with him, the answer is yes, joyous yes. Sentence 9.
As mediator between the two worlds, he knows what you have need of and what will not hurt you.
So here it's telling us that the Holy Spirit is a mediator between the two worlds. You might want to underline that. I wrote it out in the column there. The Holy Spirit is our mediator. The Holy Spirit as mediator knows what we have need of. We do not have to make a list. We do not have to keep praying in prayer. I need this, I need that, I need the other. We do this. Holy Spirit understands. And Holy Spirit will also provide what will not hurt us. So sometimes we wish for things that will lead us away from our awakening, that will hold us in time instead of quickening time. Realize that your guide knows what you need, and you don't have to make the list. You can be quiet in your mind, turn to the Holy Spirit, and just say, it's all up to you. It's not up to me. Show me what you would have me do, where you would have me go, what you would have me say, and to whom. In the times that I have truly done this, I saw miracles. And they are miracles because things begin to happen that you know you did not orchestrate. Miracles are beautiful, and they are our right, according to A Course in Miracles, because they are corrections to what is not so. Sentence 10.
Ownership is a dangerous concept if it is left to you. The ego wants to have things for salvation, for possession is its law. Possession for its own sake is the ego's fundamental creed, a basic cornerstone in the churches it builds to itself. And at its altar, it demands you lay all the things it bids you get, leaving you no joy in them.
Notice that the ego is the part of the mind that wants to possess, because in ownership, it thinks itself bigger. So all of us can learn from that sentence. Every time you're ready to purchase something, search for something, go sign a contract for something, pause, ask Holy Spirit again. Is this according to your will? Is this good for me? Will it lead me to happiness instead of away from it? What would you choose for me? Pause, make room for him, and make sure that the answer is coming from the higher realm of consciousness. If you're not sure, then just pause and then follow the peace. If it's peaceful after you have asked if this is right and good, then generally that's a good way to go. If it's not the right way, you will see it. There will be a detour or an obstacle that seems to point you in another direction. But pause before you take on anything of this world, even a relationship. And ask Holy Spirit to make it holy and to show you the highest and happiest experience and to guide you all the way. Then you can be assured it will be happy. Paragraph 11.
Everything the ego tells you that you need will hurt you. For although the ego urges you again and again to get, it leaves you nothing. For what you get, it will demand of you. And even from the very hands that grasp it, it will be wrenched and hurled into the dust. For where the ego sees salvation, it sees separation, and so you lose whatever you have gotten in its name.
I think Terry and I can attest to this, that as much as you work and you think and you problem solve, and then all of a sudden you find yourself perhaps and everything has been lost. And I think we've both been through that a number of times, actually. It's not until we start listening to our guide that knows what will not hurt us. Gifts of God come without deception, that we can be assured of a happy journey. So be sure to pause and ask about everything, especially those things where you feel that your peace is not stable. Ask Holy Spirit to decide for you. The ego, anything that it offers, it goes by the mandate of seek but do not find. It means it's not set up to make you happy. It's not set up to bring you joy that is consistent. It is set up to fail. but what is offered by the Holy Spirit through the guidance of Holy Spirit will come with consistent joy and happiness. Sentence 5.
Well, also, just to share about my little picture I drew with all the sinking boats. It was exactly that. It was people, places, things, everything I could possibly think of. Since beginning to study The Course in Miracles more in depth, the very first thing that came to me that I did not put on a boat, I have not lost, and that's you.
Well, I'm here. That's so sweet. It's so sweet. And I'm not going anywhere. We're here. So.
You came completely unexpectedly.
That's right. Very unexpected. Can't wait to have a nice powwow with all you guys in person so we can just talk about the more personal journey and really get to share with you as our friends. So looking forward to that sometime soon. Sentence number 5.
Therefore, ask not of yourself what you need, for you do not know, and your advice to yourself will hurt you. For what you think you need will merely serve to tighten up your world against the light and render you unwilling to question the value that this world can really hold for you.
Those would be wonderful sentences to underline or star. Ask not of yourself what you need, for you do not know, and your advice to yourself will hurt you. This is because our mind is still clouded in fear. We are brilliant because Holy Spirit is our guide, but when we are thinking away from what is true and we have fear in our mind, we are not as bright. It's important to remember that we do not know the answer. We cannot know what we need, but there is a place within us that does know. Then we can be willing to receive that answer. In paragraph number 13, I wrote in the margin there that the Holy Spirit knows what we need. So let's be sure to remember that. Paragraph 12.
Only the Holy Spirit knows what you need, for he will give you all things that do not block the way to light.
Let's say right now you need an answer about something. It's coming up. You don't know what's going to happen. Remind yourself you cannot know. You never knew. This is not new. So once you realize that, you can put that one down. The ego loves to say, well, what are you going to do? You don't know what's going to happen. Well, we've never known what's going to happen. That's false. Let's pause and let's remember that only Holy Spirit knows what we need, and we do not know. So pause, quiet your mind, stop trying to figure it out, lay it down, make room for him, make room for the answer that is happy. You see, sometimes it doesn't turn out so happy because we are way more committed to the unhappy answer than we are to the happy answer. You see, we don't have to really think anything at all if we are relying on Holy Spirit, but it is essential that we do not decide against ourselves because Holy Spirit cannot override our decision. Holy Spirit must wait on welcome, not on time. Sentence 3.
And what else could you need? In time, he gives you all the things that you need have and will renew them as long as you have need of them. He will take nothing from you as long as you have any need of it. And yet he knows that everything you need is temporary and will but last until you step aside from all your needs and realize that all of them have been fulfilled.
Let's look at sentence number 4. You might want to underline it. In time, he gives you all things that you need have and will renew them as long as you have need of them. That sums it up. If we knew that we could go through life with all things that we need, he says he will give us all things that we need and then renew them if we need them. If you have everything that you need, everything that you need, not necessarily everything that you've put on a list, but everything that you could possibly need, you lack nothing. And you could be absolutely at peace. But the problem is we don't believe that God gives us what we need. We believe we have to fill the gap. We believe there is a gap. And we believe that it is up to us to fill that gap. There is no gap. Go over to the other side of that fence in your mind and remind yourself again and again that God will give me all things that I need and will renew anything I need as long as I need them. And there will be a day where I will realize, as in sentence 6, that all of the things that I need have been fulfilled. So let's not be afraid. God is love. God is thorough. I like to think of God as retroactive. Even if we feel we screwed it up, that God is retroactive, so we need not fear. Sentence 7.
I like thinking of this next sentence as when Holy Spirit sends you something, but he doesn't say, you know, take good care of it because I'm going to want it back. Therefore, he has no investment in the things that he supplies, except to make certain that you will not use them on behalf of lingering in time. He knows that you are not at home there, and he wills no delay to wait upon your joyous homecoming.
Now that's a line that's important about he holds no investment in the things that he supplies. So whatever's joyful in your heart that you need to move forward, that's great. Except to make certain that you will not use what is given you to linger in time. So be sure that you're not trying to get things that will make you stay here longer. The whole point is to wake you up so that you will know what is true. Let's not linger in time. So let's ask for the joyful things that will quicken our awakening. Paragraph number 13. And in the margin there, I just wrote the word safety because that's important to so many. And just a line that goes down the paragraph there. So let's talk about safety here. Paragraph 13.
Leave then your needs to him. He will supply them with no emphasis at all upon them. What comes to you of him comes safely, for he will ensure it never can become a dark spot hidden in your mind and kept to hurt you. Under his guidance, you will travel light and journey lightly, for his sight is ever on the journey's end, which is his goal.
When Holy Spirit is giving to us and helping, directing us, that his sight is always on the journey's end of awakening. But realize that once you are asking Holy Spirit for guidance, and then you are receiving according to the will of God, that I love this sentence where it says, what comes to you of him comes safely, for he will ensure it never can become a dark spot hidden in your mind and kept to hurt you. Let's realize that all gifts that come from our Creator cannot be kept to hurt us, and they will always come with safety. And this is ensured to have no dark spots. Sentence 5.
God's Son is not a traveler through outer worlds. However holy his perception may become, no world outside himself holds his inheritance. Within himself, he has no needs, for light needs nothing but to shine in peace, and from itself to let the rays extend in quiet to infinity.
We are the light of God, and we are here to shine and extend. We forget this sometimes. We have a perfect guide to remind us. But realize that we are here to be our true self. And the quicker we remember, the quicker we wake up. I put down in the left my column here next to paragraph 14 to memorize this. It seemed very important to me. Let's start there. Paragraph 14.
Whenever you are tempted to undertake a useless journey that would lead away from light, remember what you really want and say, the Holy Spirit leads me unto Christ, and where else would I go? What need have I but to awake in him?
That is so beautiful, and it is a great rule of thumb for decision making. In every decision, you could ask yourself, does this lead me towards the light or away from it? And you can substitute that word. You could say, does this decision lead me towards greater peace or away from it? Does it lead me towards more love and happiness and joy or away from it? So just ask yourself those very clear questions. Usually you have your answer and you'll know that you are listening to Holy Spirit. Paragraph 15.
Then follow him in joy with faith that he will lead you safely through all dangers to your peace of mind this world may set before you. Kneel not before the altars to sacrifice, and seek not what you will surely lose. Content yourself with what you will as surely keep, and be not restless, for you undertake a quiet journey to the peace of God, where He would have you be in quietness.
When you hear these words, they're so beautiful, but when they're put into practice, they are so powerful. Let's say someone is asking you to do something you don't want to do, whatever it is. Maybe they want you to loan them money and you feel like this is not a good situation, or they want you to come and do something for them that you do not really want to do. Maybe they're asking you to do something for someone else that you don't have time for, or you have another commitment. These are the times we can feel so confused, because we want to be helpful, we want to be loving and supportive, and yet sometimes it feels like we have other commitments and other things going on, and then we just feel overwhelmed by it all. But we could remind ourselves at least parts of this sentence in paragraph 15, where it says, "I am going to follow you, Holy Spirit, in joy. I am going to have faith that you will lead me safely past all dangers, sacrifice, and pain and suffering, and I am going to get to the peace of mind that you will show me, even here in this world." You see, I just reworded sentence number one. So I am going to follow you in joy. I'm going to have faith that you will lead me safely past this mess. That's the shorter version. You can reword these so that you can memorize them. But you see, when someone is asking something of you that is not peaceful, that is the perfect moment to pause and engage Holy Spirit. You are not asked to suffer. You are not asked to sacrifice. But we believe we are, and we forget to ask and choose again. And so then we continue on the suffering path. Pause, turn it over, refuse it, and follow Holy Spirit in joy, trusting the plan and being certain that Holy Spirit loves you completely and is leading you to the highest and happiest answer in the quickest possible way. This is a time for trust and faith and listening without agenda. Stay focused. Stand with us. You're going to see results. Paragraph 16.
In me, you have already overcome every temptation that would hold you back. We walk together on the way to quietness that is the gift of God. Hold me dear, for what except your brothers can you need? We will restore to you the peace of mind that we must find together. The Holy Spirit will teach you to awaken unto us and to yourself. This is the only real need to be fulfilled in time. Salvation from the world lies only here. My peace I give you. Take it of me in glad exchange for all the world has offered but to take away, and we will spread it like a veil of light across the world's sad face, in which we hide our brothers from the world and it from them.
If you take a paragraph like that, it is so rich and deep and reassuring. If we just listen to the words, we might miss it. But if we just dive in a little bit, he's telling us, and think of the good news about this. We have already overcome every temptation in the world, every temptation that would hold us back. We have already overcome it. I want you to hear that, because we try so hard every day to overcome our temptations, to overcome our judgments. He's only asking us to overcome them in time so that we can get back to what has already been overcome in eternity, so we can wake up. It's not something we're actually trying to solve. It's something we are trying to understand has already been solved. So it's already done. And think of the joy of that. Secondly, it says we walk together on a way to quietness that is the gift of God. So we are together in this. And the way is quiet. It's not intended to be filled with strife and suffering and struggle. He says, hold me dear, for what except your brothers can you need? He's telling us there that the way we hold on to him, the Holy Spirit, is by holding on to our brothers. Do not judge them. Do not condemn them. And you will be holding Holy Spirit through them. And then he says, we, God, Holy Spirit, and your brothers, once you recognize Holy Spirit in them, will restore to you the peace of mind that we must find together. You see, this is not a single person job. This has to be done with everyone and Holy Spirit together. And then it says, you see, it's so rich. It says Holy Spirit is the one that's going to teach you to awaken unto everyone else and to yourself. It is not your function to do this. It is the Holy Spirit's function to teach you how to wake up for yourself and through and with your brothers. He says this is the only real need to be fulfilled in time. That's the only need, is to learn how to wake up through the Holy Spirit by seeing the Holy Spirit in everyone, especially when they are not showing it to you. That is when it is most necessary. He says this is where salvation of the world is, and that he, in sentence 8, is giving us his peace. He's asking us to take his peace from him in a glad exchange for all the world has offered, but then took away. When we do this, and we receive his peace, and we exchange our sorrow, that's a good trade, and then, and only then, we spread it like a veil of light across the world's sad face, in which we hide our brothers from the world, meaning we don't see them in the truth of who they are. We accept the story we have made, and we hide the world from them. But once this exchange is done and we receive that guidance, we spread the veil of light across the world's sad face, and we will see the happy dream. All of that is in that one paragraph. And I just thought it was beautiful. All right, here we are, our last paragraph for tonight, paragraph 17.
We cannot sing redemption's hymn alone. My task is not completed until I have lifted every voice with mine, and yet it is not mine, for as it is my gift to you, so was it the Father's gift to me, given me through his Spirit. The sound of it will banish sorrow from the mind of God's most holy Son, where it cannot abide.
You see, everyone in our dream, in our life experience, has to remember what is true before we are completely aware of what is true. You can't have a part of your mind that doesn't get it. That might seem insurmountable, but I task you all with a willingness to see everyone as capable of waking up. You see, we're all playing roles with each other. And those that have been playing the dark, deceptive villain role, or the one that is the attacker, the persecutor, the liar, we must be determined to see them differently. We are the dreamer of our dream. You might have people in your life that you think are so far away from the light that they could never get there. Refuse this idea. Abandon it completely. Because what God created has never been undone by the story that we made up. Remember, it's a waking up. It's not a solving of a real problem. It is a remembering that the problem has been solved already. And this means that people in our experience can wake up very, very quickly, much faster than we can imagine, because the problem is not being solved. It is being recognized as solved. This makes things very fast. So no matter who you see as dark, devious, dishonest, lying, hurtful, mean, sick, sad, or broke, be determined to see them differently. Hold the light of Christ in your mind. Be willing to see that in them. Be willing to see them so happy and receiving the blessings right along with you. Because if we would exclude them, then separation is real. If we would exclude them because we don't like them, then we have decided that the dream role we made up is more important than the truth. Be aware of those thoughts. They are blocking the light from your eyes. Sentence 5.
Healing in time is needed, for joy cannot establish its eternal reign where sorrow dwells. You dwell not here, but in eternity. You travel but in dreams, while safe at home. Give thanks to every part of you that you have taught how to remember you. Thus does the Son of God give thanks unto his Father for his purity.
There's another awesome quote. Give thanks to every part of you that you have taught how to remember you. I just think that's fantastic. Let's remember that we travel but in dreams while safe at home. Somewhere in our mind, we remember our true self, our true identity. The world we see is not it, and we want to see the real world instead of this. Holy Spirit is the guide. We are already safe. We are already at home in God. Breathe that in. Tell yourself that 100 times if you need to, because when you open your eyes, you will see that you are safe and at home. It will come to you very quickly, but be certain that love is real. Be willing to draw that certainty from Holy Spirit until you have your own, and be certain that you are deeply and dearly loved and that God has not lost your file. Refuse that idea. Be unwilling to spin that around in your mind. Stay focused on Holy Spirit's voice. If you can't get to a good thought, that's okay. It's not up to you. But be willing to rely on Holy Spirit's good thoughts. They are always there, ever present. You can rely on them until you have your own. Terry, let's go ahead and finish up here tonight with one of your Q&As.
Absolutely. Before I do that, I just wanted to share something that came to mind, that if for any of us, tomorrow, we suddenly find from Holy Spirit in our hand, we're holding the winning lottery ticket. You now have $100 million. Or somehow mysteriously a map shows up in your possession and it leads you to a cave filled with gold bars. Just know, it's okay to receive, but don't let it hold you in time. And to share 2 words from the lesson that we studied today, for my brothers, just remember, travel light, travel light. So my question that we have today is, we have always heard the name Jesus Christ, or simply Christ, throughout time. What does it really mean? And the answer comes in the workbook for students, right after workbook lesson number 270. And it is question number 6, entitled, What is the Christ? Christ is God's Son as He created Him. He is the self we share, uniting us with one another. He is the thought which still abides within the mind that is His source. He has not left His holy home, nor lost the innocence in which He was created. He abides unchanged forever in the mind of God. Christ is the link that keeps you one with God and guarantees that separation is no more than an illusion of despair, for hope forever will abide in Him. Your mind is part of His, and His of yours. His is the part in which God answers lies, where all decisions are already made, where dreams are over. This is the only part of you that has reality and truth. The rest is dreams. Yet will these dreams be given unto Christ to fade before His glory and reveal your holy self, the Christ, to you at last.
That is so beautiful. We finish here tonight with the idea that Christ is in our mind, the clear state of consciousness where all decisions are already made and where dreams are over. There's a place in our mind that is already clear and certain and wise and safe and fulfilled. Our part is to ask Holy Spirit to help us remember that place in our mind and to be unwilling to engage illusions as much as possible. We have learned to seek first the kingdom of God, and everything else is added unto us. So let's keep our focus on seeking first what is true, and then we receive all the perks and benefits of what is true. That's the effect. So today, Holy Spirit, we come to you with gratitude, and we ask for clear guidance as you always give, but we are willing to receive that guidance into our mind. And whatever it is that we are trying to work out or move through, we ask for very clear signals. We choose to remember tonight after our lesson that we are safe we are provided for, that dreams are already over in our true mind, and we want the peace that is the will of God. And we are worthy, and we are ready, and we are happy learners. We are listening to only your voice as much as possible. And when we forgive ourselves. It is not up to us. Thank you in advance for the highest and happiest experience for everyone here and beyond, that whatever it is we need, we already have, and we will see it as such as we welcome the truth back into our mind. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your deep and perfect love. You know all of our needs. We don't have to make a list for you. You already know. We are blessed beyond measure. We receive the blessings of our Creator with open heart, open mind. Your will be done. Amen.